sure that more people would get a chance to come, but I know that some of you folks have to leave earlier, so I want to get going. I'm Martin Ali, the Associate Director of the Ralph Bunce, J. Bunce Center for African American Studies, and the first request that Professor Strickland has asked is that you come a bit over to this side, those of you who are a bit farther away. It's good for the cameras, and it'll probably be good for our speaker as well. It is my indeed great honor to introduce Professor Strickland today. The last time we were in the same room together was a little short of 20 years ago, when he was at the announcement for Jesse Jackson's first presidential campaign, and that was at the D.C. Convention Center back then. And I was an undergrad at Howard University, and Bill Strickland was starting out the first Jesse Jackson campaign for president. And that is a very memorable moment in my life, because that had a very interesting, there was an interesting statement made by Marion Barry at that event. He said, many people are saying, should Jesse Jackson run? And Marion Barry said, well, you know, can Jesse afford not to run? And one of the problems that we have today is the luxury, or the lack of a luxury, in not doing anything in these critical times, when we have a Patriot Act that's in effect and attempts to put through another one. And then we have African Americans basically fighting among themselves over the political status of blacks in the White House, and also blacks who are being more recently appointed to the bench. That's news from this week. So Bill Strickland is a very timely speaker for us. He's someone who has walked the walk and talked the talk. He's what you could call a scholar activist. And one of his more recent publications is Malcolm X, Make It Plain, that came out in 1994. But he has been involved in the modern student movement, the Student Nonviolent Coordinating Committee, which many of us know as SNCC, the Mississippi Freedom Democratic Party, and Malcolm X. He's been involved with Malcolm X in organizing, et cetera. And in 1984, as I said, he was working with Jesse Jackson on that first campaign, and also in 1988 in that second campaign. So Bill Strickland is going to talk today about election 2004, a black perspective on America. And without any further ado, I yield the floor to Professor Strickland.
Thank you, Mark. I want to begin by thanking the sponsors of Ralph Bunce Center in the Race and Policy and the Political Science. The situation reminds me of a lesson I learned from C.L.R. James, Bobby, I think, was in attendance. We were both members of the Institute of the Black World, Atlanta, Georgia. And then Bobby left to go to Dartmouth. And C.L.R. came to Dartmouth to speak in the winter, much like my own most experience, being having snow problems flying here. C.L.R. came with 15 people in the audience. C.L.R. gave the same speech for that audience as though he were speaking before the United Nations. And he taught us a valuable lesson about pride and vanity and telling the truth regardless of the circumstances. Let me be clear about my perspective before I begin. Several years ago, Arnold Lee, before he became Hakeem, just after he became Hakeem, wrote a book called Enemies. And one of the things that Malcolm used to say, in his own inimitable style, you would begin as many of us talked by saying, friends, brothers and sisters, friends, and enemies. And he'd say, now you all know that you do have enemies, because you wouldn't be here if some enemy had brought you. So that my perspective on the forthcoming election, I must say, is pessimistic on the one hand and hopeful on the other. The pessimism arises from that I believe that this administration is not only dishonest, it is unscrupulous. And people have no idea about the depth of their immorality, the depth of their unscrupulousness. So what I want to do is try and explain where that perspective comes from, my own perspective on the unscrupulousness, to share that with you, but in the limited time that we have, because this comes from a much larger work, I'm going to skip around. And things that may not appear coherent, perhaps in a question and answer period, will in fact be coherent. But while Mark was giving a brief kind of description, he did mention that our program is one of the very first in the country. We have an awarded PhD in Afro-American Studies, and I'm proud of one of our first graduates. Ta-da! Is here. Stand up here. That's a fundamental question that black people, especially, and all people, need now to confront. Where is this train called America? I won't reiterate things that I'm sure all of you know about the falsehoods for this contrived and concocted war. Part of my perspective comes from the fact that over the past 2 years I've been out of it. How many people have been out of this country since the last year and a half? I hope you've noticed the difference between the media abroad and the media. We are perhaps wherever Goebbels is. I'm sure he's applauding what's happening in this country. We are perhaps the most propagandized people in the world. And you don't know it until you're outside. I came back from Spain, and I was curious about press coverage. So I brought back this particular story. I said, well, what was the reaction of America when this story hit? And everybody said, the story never did hit. This is Murdoch's paper, the London Times, in August. The lead story is Dr. Kelly, the alleged suicide. Kelly said, 6 months ago, this is August, I will probably be found dead in the woods. Now, 6 months ago was February, was exactly that period when Powell was preparing his remarks at the United Nations, when Kelly predicted that he might be found dead in the woods. And 6 months later, he was found dead. Now I believe in coincidences, but at least I thought it would be a story in this country. Evidently it was not a story. If you recall the winter meeting prior to the invasion of Iraq, between among Blair and Bush and the head of the Spanish government, Aznar, the Prime Minister of Partido Popular, there was a coordination among them. In Spain, they were telling the story that the false information that was communicated, disseminated here, was also disseminated in Spain. Aznar gave it to 19 of his generals. Defense Minister Federico Trillo admitted Tuesday that his ministry had orientated, quote unquote, military analysts with information about Iraq during the buildup to the US-led invasion. it became known that the Defense Ministry has selected 19 military officers for more than 150 media interviews before and during the Iraq War, supplying them with a 62-page manual supporting the government's position. 90% of the people in Spain opposed Spanish participation in the war. And a Spanish journalist was killed in the war, and subsequently the Spanish soldiers have been killed. This goes to one of the characteristics of the Bush machine. As one of Bobby's mentors and mine said, there are facts, and then there are facts. But the most important thing is what is the significance of facts. In February, 15 million people protested the forthcoming invasion of Iraq. 15 million. That's the largest demonstration in the history of the world. The largest demonstration against the American government was the largest demonstration in the history of the world. But no one puts these facts into context. So, let me talk about the 2004 election. I think we have to go back to two things. What is the character, what is the actual nature of this administration? For those of you who are here tonight, how many people have heard of the project for the New American Century? You can go on the web and check it out. The plans to invade Iraq go back into the 1980s. If you read Bush, I'll try, as I mentioned, various things to mention references. If you read Woodward's book, which is a great pen to Bush and Boyd, but the Washington Post last December indicated that Bush had given the Pentagon orders a week after 9/11 for two invasion plans. A week after 9/11, an invasion plan for Afghanistan and that invasion plan for Iraq. So all of this business. ¿Alguien aquí habla español? Nobody has speaks.
Un poquito, señor.
Un poquito. All this is a great Spanish word. Se llama caca. I see you all know the key Spanish word. All of this so-called buildup was all false. It was all simply propaganda. There's a book that came out by a man named David Brock. It's called Blinded by the Right. And this is what Brock says. We're talking about what was a shadow government that is now in control of the United States of America. It controls the House, and it controls the Senate. It controls the White House. And although there is great shouting and tumult about the Supreme Court, and there is press coverage about Miguel Estrada's nomination and now Pickering nomination, the unfortunate fact is that 162 of Bush's nominees have been appointed to the Federal Appeals Court. They control the Appeals Court, which is why they get all these little funny decisions. So it is not enough. This is part of pessimism. Dot number one. We may focus on Bush, but the fundamental danger is they have penetrated each and every institution in this political system. The courts, they have appointed 2/3 of all the federal judges under Bush 1 and Reagan, and now you have another 162. They control a majority of the appeals courts. The press, which is how we began this discussion, the press is in their pocket for a variety of reasons. Anyway, Brock talks about this shadow government. This is a terrible book. It's about lies told and reputations ruined. It's about what the conservative movement did and what I did as we plotted in the shadows, disregarded the law, and abused power to win ever greater power. I recommend that you get Brock's book. As I said, it's called Blinded by the Right. There's another book called Up for Conservatism by another former, in which he discusses how they use the race card, which I'm sure you're all aware of. They have used the race card from Reagan's welfare queens and Bush 1, Billy Horton, to gain the cusp of power that now places them at the gives them the capacity, rather, to pursue their true ambitions, which is now it's become semi-conventional to acknowledge it, to be the new Rome, to be the new imperial power. There's something called the Defense Policy Group, you know, which Pearl and others were members. They had one of their analysts, is a man named Vasevich. Vasevich talked about how de rigueur it had become for people to acknowledge the U.S. As a sole superpower in the world. But then he said their real ambition, I was reading this in Spain, and I was drinking wine at the time, I had to stop and get a funny. Listen, their real ambition was to control the world until the end of the time. These people are crazy. Even Hitler said in the Third Reich would last 1,000 years. These people say, hasta el fin del tiempo, until the end of time. So they're not only unscrupulous, they are out to lunch. Here is Brock's description of the shadow government that now rules. Like the American and other Western Communist parties in their heyday, the American conservative movement has created a kind of alternative intellectual and political universe, a set of institutions parallel to and modeled on the institutions of mainstream society and dedicated to the single purpose of advancing a predetermined political agenda. There is a kind of inner movement consisting of a few hundred fundraisers, senior organization leaders, lawyers, and prominent media personalities, and an outer movement consisting of a few thousand staff people, grunt workers, and lower level operatives of one kind or another. This movement has its own newspapers, its own magazines, its own broadcasting operations, its own publishing houses, its own quasi-academic research institutions, for those of you who have studied communism, and even its own popular front, the Republican Party, important elements of which it has successfully commandeered. This means when we talk about, and I sent this brief bio to Alex about the gas bullets, I said one of the things I wanted to talk about was the intellectual and political vacuum confronting Black America, confronting Americans, but in general for Black Americans. So that, again, it is not sufficient to focus on Bush. We must focus on this inner movement, which is this outer movement, which has now become the government of the United States. It counts among not only the crazies, but criminals. Bush has resurrected Negroponte and Abrams and Poindexter, who had this program called TIPS, where you're going to have the postman and electrician spying on you.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. And it's not the most outlandish things sometimes surface, and then they'll pull them back because they've been exposed. But that doesn't mean their mindset and their intentions have changed. Their intention was to lie. They called it the Office of Strategic Diplomacy. They were going to lie to their allies. Bush is not love. Yes, that's obvious. Bush is not love. Would you love a man or trust a man? Well, we'll hold that. Let me ask you another question. Bush just made this whirlwind tour, right? Stopped at Indonesia. Do you know how many soldiers we used to protect him while he was in Indonesia? Bush stayed at the airport. They thought that was the safest place for him. He couldn't venture away. He flew into the airport with the Secret Service detail, and the government of Indonesia organized a protection detail of 5,000 soldiers. Of 5,000 soldiers to protect the leader of your country, who cannot go anywhere in the world safely. The U.S. has spent $4.3 billion to beef up its embassies abroad. Only the United States and Israel have embassies or are in fact fortresses. Loved as our beacon, I mean, and projected as the world's beacon of democracy. So, the fact that Bush is not loved has particular consequences for the rest of us, which we'll come back to. But the problem is not simply Bush, it is also the Republican Party, which is the organized expression of reaction in this country. Now, there may be, I don't want to talk about them all, their leadership. Within their ranks, their, I'm a friend or two is Republican, but the, and there are some people with integrity, like the former Governor Ryan of Illinois, who placed a moratorium on the death penalty. You have Jeffers of New Hampshire, who left the party. You should read what Jeffers said while he left the Republican Party. And in the recent in the recent bill for $87 billion, because they hadn't accounted for the $70 billion they asked for in April, seven Republicans voted against the bill, which was almost twice as many as the number of Democrats who voted against the bill. Seven Republicans voted against it, only five Democrats voted against it, which is another problem. There is no institutional opposition to the right wing, which has taken the whole thing. So we have this problem of the perversion of political institutions, the surrender of Congress, the capitulation of the Democratic Party, such that we exist in this ironic situation with the most consistently trenchant political commentary in this land comes from comic strips. Trudeau and Boondocks are on the case infinitely more wonderfully than the Democratic Party at all. But they've also infected the culture, which has caused pessimism number two. So this erstwhile shadow government is now coming from the cold, transforming the political and economic landscape. Escape from constitutional democracy to military corporate autocracy, while re-costuming social culture as well. Now the entrepreneur has become a role model. Corporations and government devalue humanities and fine arts while funding science and business at universities. Sports stadiums, usually built with taxpayers' money, are auctioned off to the highest corporate bidder, for example, the recently deceased Enron Field in Houston, while copyright law expands to control music, books, bioengineered food, and even facts themselves. Subordinated to this ubiquitous corporate ethos, human value and human life have been reduced to the bottom line. Thus, any movement for social change must recognize that the task is not strictly political, but also profoundly cultural. That the fight is not only against individuals and organizations, but also against mindsets that want to turn universities into vocational schools and give American children only so much education as they can pay for. Mindsets that want to gag doctors so they cannot inform patients of costly medical procedures that may save their life. Mindsets that are closing down public hospitals and mental institutions and building prisons instead. Mindsets that raise rents to fair market value and turn fixed income Americans into the new homeless. Mindsets that only authorize organ transplants for the right people and restrict access to combination AIDS drugs to those who can afford their multi-thousand costs. This infectious right-wing mindset has deeply wounded morality and humanity in America, turning us into an indifferent nation, oblivious to race and class-driven wrongdoing, as our attention is directed only to the sanctioned scapegoats, black criminals, suspected terrorists, Saddam Hussein, and when he was in office, Bill Clinton. This masterful diversionary tactic is like the Klingon cloaking device in Star Trek, concealing the real political and economic culture to have seized the scepter of state and now rule over us all. Why we are not loved, this Rome that wants to rule forever, whose mindset was itself revealed long before 9/11. United States was the only country in the world to oppose the treaty to combat germ warfare. The United States opposed the treaty to ban biological weapons because, quote, it would put national security and confidential business information at risk. The ABM treaty, the United States is allegedly has signed a new treaty with Russia, abrogating the 30-year-old treaty, but then they told poor Putin that they weren't going to draw down, that this was going to only draw down to 2,600, and they're going to keep the rest in their warehouse. They also have the right to repudiate the treaty at any time. So this was hailed as a great advance, but in fact it was, once again, us. North Korea, even before the Axis of Evil demagogue, which intervened in the thawing political relations between North and South Korea. We remember that Madeleine Albright went to North Korea in 2000, and they were projecting a visit by Clinton. They sent Kelly, who calls Kim Jong-il names, calls the man names, and then what would you do if you were Kim Jong-il? What has Kim Jong-il asked for? What tremendous, right as he requested from this government. He has simply asked, given the experience of this Bush's new so-called preventive war thing, policy, all Kim Jong-il asked for was the United States to sign a non-aggression pact. All he asked was, would you please say you will not attack us? Bush said, now I'm going to send another bad Spanish word. Bush said, no. Now he's making little noises. Maybe they cannot sign a treaty, but maybe they can say, okay, we won't attack. CIA and other intelligence people, actually CIA has been playing a very interesting role, but they said, well, he's got maybe two bombs. And if he's got two bombs, they can't go any farther than Hawaii. Kim Jong-il said, oh, that's wrong, I can get Philadelphia and Washington, D.C. So now they said, maybe he's got eight or ten bombs. So while they're talking about this mythical threat posed by Saddam, after the United States and Britain had sent thousands and thousands of sorties against Iraq from 1991 until 2000, thousands of military sorties, where the UN had been in there imposing sanctions, and now Mr. K comes back after spending $300 million and says he cannot find any weapons. The same people who told us that Saddam could launch weapons in 45 minutes and 25,000. And the press says, the New York Times said, well, Bush may have exaggerated, but he didn't lie. Of course he lied. And there are a spate of new books documenting his lie. It's Conison's book on the right wing, new book called Big Lies, the Right Wing Propaganda Machine. There's a new book by David Cohen called The Lies of George Bush. Paul Krugman, the new editorial writer from the New York Times, has a new book just looking at all of the false statements in terms of the economy. So, you gratuitously insult North Korea, who is a much more of a real danger than any of the mythical dangers that they have sold to the American people. The landmine treaty. The Pentagon opposed a treaty against landmines signed by 123 nations, including all 16 members of NATO, because it wants to keep landmines in Korea and on European military bases in violation of the treaty. The International Criminal Court. The United States opposed the Treaty of Rome establishing an International Criminal Court in The Hague, and then in May of 2001, unsigned the treaty. This is an unprecedented action, since no president has ever before revoked the treaty signature of another chief executive. Now, here are the crazies. They not only unsigned the treaty. Tom DeLay, Republican of Texas and majority whip, promoted something called the Armed Services Protection Act. The purpose of this act is to rescue any American who might be brought before the new International Criminal Court of Justice. DeLay said he had spoken personally with Secretary of Defense Rumsfeld and Secretary of State Powell, and both had endorsed his bill in its entirety. The Lay's account was confirmed by Victoria Farr, Assistant Secretary of Defense, who said that while I am confident the Secretary has not read every line, he is very supportive of the intent. This proclivity toward endorsing legislation which officials have not entirely read, like Patriot Act. Ashcroft slammed the Patriot Act and the Congress passed it. He gave them a limited version of the Patriot Act. He gave them a summary of some 130 pages when the entire Patriot Act is over 300 pages, but they voted for it without having read it. And now he's got Patriot Act 2 in the hopper. So here we go back to the Armed Services Protection Act. Democrat Dave Obie says to DeLay that most committee members did not know what was in his 28-page document, and DeLay said the threat to American troops was so urgent that we don't have time for folk to read the bill. Don't have time for folk to read the bill. But that still wasn't the end of this little comic tableau. When Obie then went on to point out to DeLay that some members did not know that the court was located in The Hague, and that we would be sending our troops to invade the Netherlands, DeLay said he did not consider that a serious question. These Turkeys were passing a law to make war against Holland, but didn't know The Hague was in Holland. There are no words to describe this. This defies description about the people who are making decisions for us. They're not only religious zealots, they're not only empire mongers. At the very, some of them are out constitutionally to lunch. So go back and when you leave class, go to the video store and get out Strange Love so you can be in concert. So, to 2004. I think to understand the dangers of 2004, we have to go back to 2000 and what happened in that election. It's something I said, it's the coup that was called the election. And it's symptomatic of our problem because it encapsulates many of the features that define the current political crisis. The unscrupulousness of Republican strategists, the wimpish non-combativeness of Democrats, the right-wing manipulation of political and legal systems, the subversion of black political rights, the right-wing tilt of the media, the national apathy of most of the white electorate, and the frustration of those other Americans who rightly perceived they were victims of a monstrous political scam that went unmobilized and unled. Since the beginning of the Republic, we have been taught that the essence of democracy resides in the system of checks and balances manifested in all three branches of government, the executive, the legislative, and judiciary. But since the elections of 1994, a right-wing party that is anti-choice, anti-labor, anti-city, anti-mass transportation, anti-public housing, anti-public education, anti-gun control, anti-immigrants, except in your sweatshops and in your supermarkets, anti-clean air and anti-clean water, anti-raising the minimum wage, anti-national health insurance, anti-welfare, unless it's corporate welfare, anti-banning nuclear testing, ad infinitum. And the Democrats cannot put together a critique. They cannot put together a critique. My dog put together a critique. It orchestrates a 5-vote majority in the Supreme Court, has appointed, as I mentioned, a majority of the federal judges, and routinely garners more than 30 million votes from an electorate whose interest is skewed daily. Thus, as the year 2000 dawned, it had only to capture the White House to complete its coup. Then the last domino would fall. That is why Florida was so important. It was potentially the weak link in the Republican's successful Southern strategy that had, since 1964 and Lyndon Johnson, prevented any Democratic presidential candidate from winning a majority of the white vote. You understand that? No Democratic candidate for president has won a majority of the white vote since 1964. That is the racist base that has brought the Republican Party to unlimited power. That is the great political secret that has flummoxed Democrats, empowered Republicans, and castrated the American two-party system. Now, this the Southern strategy is the linchpin of the Republican political strategy, and it's based on the Electoral College. There are 535 electoral votes, 100 senators, and 435 congresspersons. A simple majority of approximately 270 votes is all that's required to elect a president. The 11 states of the Confederacy equaled 153. That's 55%, 56% of all that's needed. California has 55 electoral votes, which is why they love you guys. You have 55. So if the Republicans can sweep the South as Bush did, winning all 11 Confederate states, Southern states, in the last election, and win four or five other key states, they can force the Democrats to win nearly 70%. They must win 70% to win the election. So it's possible, therefore, thanks to the Electoral College system, with the right combination of less than 20 states, to become president of the United States. Therefore, one of our demands must be abandonment of the Electoral College.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Sure. It is a relic of slavery. It is one of the fundamental compromises that the North made the slave power. Political in the coming to the Union. In fact, there's a new book by Gary Wills about Jefferson called The Negro President, in which he demonstrates that without the three-fifths clause, Jefferson never would become president. You understand that three-fifths? If you had, there were 2.5 million people in this country in 1790 when they took the first census. If you do, there's 435 people in Congress now. If you do a simple equation in your head that the average number of registered of citizens, because back in those days only white men with property were citizens.
Right.
Those were the only citizens in this great democracy. In fact, one dimension of political history is the fight of folk who were excluded at the origins of the Republic to become included in the Republic. Anyway, if you just think about it, I should ask for black people. If you go back to 1790, just keep in your head that 10,000 men, white men of property, and that equal one congressperson. You get the book by Lowell Dumont's book, which Malcolm used to quote from, called Anti-Slavery. All the great books about it, but maybe you can get it at Amazon.com. Malcolm will say, well, you notice the truth of what they said. And he has a section here about the additional political power of the Southern states aggrandized to themselves as a result of the three-fifths. But if you say, like, there were 30,000 white men of property in Virginia, they were therefore entitled. I mean, in New York, they were therefore entitled to three congresspersons. And then if you had 50,000 slaves in Virginia, and you apply the three-fifths law, they're also entitled to three congressmen. And it's only when the South can no longer rule this country that they succeed. The South rule this country. How different an image would you have of the United States if you entered high school or elementary school and they began the study of American history by saying, Abraham Lincoln was the 16th president of the United States. Of the first 15 presidents, 8 were slaveholders, and 4 others were what they called doughfaces. If you look at the video Amistad, you can see how Van Buren, the Democratic Party, was enthralled to the slave power and therefore protected its interests. It's another important book by a guy, the semi-apologist, gives us enough data to make this point. It's a book called The Slaveholding Republic by Fahrenbach. So here we go. So, Florida, we go back to Florida. Florida has 25 electoral votes. It has suddenly become an iffy proposition because of an explosion of northern Jewish retirees moving into the state and a growing number of Haitians with Democratic leanings. There were also new Latinos who were not the lockstep anti-Castro Cubans in Miami. But most threatening of all were the solidly Democratic voting blacks who had been energized by Governor Jeb Bush's anti-affirmative action initiatives and who had registered in unprecedented numbers to revenge themselves by denying his brother a Florida victory and hopefully the presidency. So here comes the election, and this is how it was explained to us. It was the press's fault. No one seemed to ask why Florida was the only state the press got wrong. And who said it got? Who said the question was still open? The man who who said the question was still open was the presidential campaign coordinator for Fox, whose name is John Ellis. Do you know who John Ellis is? He was Bush's cousin.
Right.
But there's no conspiracy. There's no conspiracy. All you all think that there's something wrong with you, but it's too much better. Funny smoke that I saw coming into the LA airport. So it's the press's fault. It was the machine's fault. But why were these defective ballots and non-counting machines overwhelmingly in Democratic voting districts? Then there was the sly racist suggestion. Well, you know, some of them can't read too good. Yeah. A real anomaly in the whole fiasco has gone largely unaddressed. The fact that in the other statewide race in Florida, the race for the Senate, the Democrat Bill Nelson won the seat over the Republican Bill McCollum, who was one of the Republican floor managers in the House Clinton impeachment proceedings. In the other statewide contest, Nelson beat McCollum by 200,000 votes. The only race where there was so much massive confusion and, quote, technological and procedural meltdown just happened to be the presidential contest. And curiously, when one tabulates all the votes lost in the various mix-ups, it turns out to be, guess what? About 200,000 votes. The whole focus on Broward County and the Chad is all irrelevant. They'd already eliminated 200,000 with the felon disfranchisement. And, well, we'll get into a little taste. Well, I'm going to get the whole Seminole County with the Republican, let's Republican Party apparatchiks come in and correct absentee ballots. And here are other things that the press did not seem fit to comment on. In Plantation, Florida, schools that had been a black voting precinct for years was demolished 3 weeks before Election Day without voters ever being informed of an alternative site, so black people were riding around the damn district trying to find out where to vote. In Miami-Dade County, 47 precincts with a substantial Haitian American population were denied Creole translators, although that assistance had been previously promised. The names of black voters who had just voted in the September primary were not on the voting rolls in November. Black voters whose names were on the rolls were turned away nevertheless. Phone lines were down in an extraordinary number of black precincts, so the calls to verify voter status could not be made. So you come and say, I just voted in September in the primary. How come my name's, then they try to call the main office. Oh, the phone lines are down. Zippity-doo-dah. Black voters were given the runaround, sent from place to place to find out where they might vote until the polls closed or they got fed up. Some ballot boxes were not picked up until days after the election, and one in Miami was even found in a Sheraton hotel room. Polls were closed with people in line who had shown up before the 7 p.m. deadline. Black voters were stopped without cause at police checkpoints near polling places and questioned while white voters were not. Some black voters were not permitted to vote unless they had at least two forms of identification. Again, white voters were not self-repeated. Some who requested aid from poll workers, the elderly, or the non-fluent English were treated indifferently or contemptuously, and then there was the felon disfranchisement. The press did not raise any of these questions. The fundamental question the press raised was, when is Gore going to be a man and quit? That was the press line. Yeah. When is Gore going to be a man and quit? Despite the fact that they had arranged, the Republicans had arranged this riot in Miami-Dade, the protest, they went and shut down the courthouse. They flew in folks from Washington, D.C., aides of various Republican politicians, which the press also never investigated. So, the fact that what they did in 2000 makes me, as I said, pessimistic about what they're prepared to do in 2004. We have tremendous obstacles. They have money power, which has already raised more money than all the Democrats together, which raised something almost something very curious that's just begun to surface. That there are new voting machines that may be used in this election. It seems that the person who is the designer is a big Republican. Supporter, and you cannot verify the accounts of these machines because of, quote, trade secrets. And there have been two anomalous results already in Georgia, where Max Cleland, who was a disabled Vietnam veteran, the guy who's sitting in the wheelchair, he lost unaccountably for these machines. So I have a reference which I can dig out.
Are these Diebold machines?
Pardon me?
Diebold machines? Is that good?
I don't know, but the guy who runs the corporation that makes them, the name isn't Diebold. It may be Diebold machines, but
it's not Diebold program. It's not Diebold lock.
I have the reference here. I can dig it out. So you have this other looming possibility about stealing the elections through the use of voting machines, and so. Immediately now, this question needs to be raised about the possibility of manipulating voting machines. We, black people, because of the subtle things that we mentioned before, in states like South Carolina, black people represent 53% of the Democratic vote. So there must be some attempt to impede the Republican strategy that I said it's irrelevant who the Democratic candidate is, in my judgment, as long as Donald Duck, if the people will rise up and demand that the Democratic Party pursue X, Y, and Z strategies in the election. As Mark mentioned, I ran Jesse's campaign in 1984 and 1988. And Jesse did move the Democratic Party. He got them to recognize Arab Americans, which they didn't have, which the Zionist lobby had prevented from being any kind of real participant in the American political process. He got them to pass legislation about plant closing. Plants were just closed without giving the workers notice, and made them at least a 60-day notice. He made Dukakis talk about death squads in Nicaragua, in El Salvador, pardon me. So he did move to and one of our plants was no first strike. He got the party to move. The people, given the way in which the institutions have been co-opted or have surrendered, the only revolts that have come from citizens, primarily in newspaper ads. But now that Cynthia McKinney just about 3 weeks ago, just talked about, mentioned that the newspapers are not accepting ads that have been paid for, that she and the Win Without War people have wanted a place in the newspapers. But the folk who read the New York Times, et cetera, don't represent the American people as a whole. Some things, we must devise ways, maybe with truth squads and lecture tours that go into this country and explain and Bush's lies. He is destroying the damn economy. We've lost 3 million jobs through his tax cuts, but the lie is already ready. They're saying he inherited the recession. It was really Clinton's fault. And the press just plays that. So that's why Krugman's stuff is so important. He looks at all of the explanations that the administration has given and shows how, in terms of the economy and elsewhere, they're all false, they're all lies. Now, people don't want to say that. They call it by different names, spin, misrepresentation, or misinformation. It's lies, Jack. L-I-E-S. They are lying. And then they change the bar with the help of establishment economists. So, as Bobby and I were discussing this on the way here to this talk, they just looked in. There's a wonderful, we should get today's New York Times, because Krugman has an article about lowering the bar. And they're still doing it. House leaders are pushing to cut corporate taxes. They want to cut corporate taxes another $100 billion. They're destroying. It is not possible. It is not possible to wage war in Iraq and Afghanistan. You know, the Afghans fought the British Empire for 120 years, from 1839 to 1957. They fought the Russians for 10 years, and 10 days ago, one of the Taliban said, we will force the United States out of Afghanistan if it takes 20 years. They don't have enough money for Afghanistan and Iraq and their tax cuts, but they're doing Reagan's strategy. When Clinton is in office, they say you must balance the budget. But when they're in office, they say deficits equal growth. Deficits do not equal growth. Deficits equal the loss of 2.7 million jobs and an increase in your tuition. And in fact, California is a poster, mm-hmm. is a poster boy for what's wrong. And it goes once again to the failure of the Democratic Party. Because if, as I understand it, Gray Davis raised your taxes, laid people off, gasoline taxes, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. If he had done the correct thing, what is the cause of your budget crisis? You were scammed by Enron for $30 billion. That's the cause of your budget crisis. Why did this cat not go to the people and demand that Enron be investigated, demand that the government establish a special prosecutor and explain to the citizens of California how they were scammed? $30 billion. Instead, he wouldn't confront the corporations, pass these ridiculous policies, and got kicked out of office. So he's a suicidal fool. There's something wrong. But he represents the failure of the Democratic Party to confront corporate corruption and to explain to people how the system works. As one of our old movement people said, if people don't want to, Bob and I were talking about this, there's this fundamental tendency on the part of Americans to be in denial. There's no evil in American history. There's no evil in America. That's why I began talking about enemies. There is evil. There has been evil. And if folks don't understand that we have enemies, as Malcolm said, who are in danger us all. Because the attack on Daniel Pearl, previously our so-called enemies, Russia, Cuba, North Korea, Vietnam, always made a distinction between the American government, China, and the American people. Notice why was Daniel Pearl killed? Daniel Pearl was killed. They demanded that the U.S. release prisoners in Guantanamo. They said, release our people in Guantanamo. The U.S. said no. They cut Pearl's throat. What is new, then they attacked a Christian missionary church in Pakistan. But it's not just Daniel Pearl. 9/11, the murder of the CIA employees in Langley, the blowing up of the coal. All these are political acts against the political and economic targets of the United States. But Daniel Pearl is different. If we're at this stage because of how Bush is unloved, where American citizens are being held accountable for the policies of this government, then we are all at risk. Go look at the 83 nationalities who were killed in 9/11. Latinos, some who were illegal, blacks working in windows of the world. We are all at risk, which is also why there's a possibility for a new political movement. If we can explain to the people who got zonked in Enron and lost their pensions, the people who got zonked by the Anderson Houdini-like figure adjustments around earning income, now it's the mutual fund. Corporate scandal after corporate scandal, and yet we cannot come to the, as Du Bois said in Black Reconstruction, I look at the evidence and I can come to only one conclusion. I look at the evidence and I can come to only one conclusion, which is not my own, and I will reiterate it because one of our most brilliant commentators said so in the movement years ago. He said, it is not true that the system is corrupt. Corruption is the system. Okay, I'll leave you time for questions.
To try one more time, those kinds of things. So could you speak a little bit about structurally in these few months to come, voter registration, information, other issues, have you thought about suggestions, structural suggestions?
Well, the major, one of my very dear friends who was, in my judgment, one of the great, perhaps the greatest political novelist of our time, John A. Williams. You read The Man of Cried Iron? John said once, the television told the truth for a week, there'd be a revolution in this country. One of our problems is that the media is controlled. So how then do we get to the people? We need to get to them. If A is true, if the administration is as corrupt as I believe it to be, then we need to kind of do some garbage stuff. We need to, some of our organizations, the NAACP and groups like that need to be radicalized. They need to get NGO status in the UN. There's a meeting in Senegal in December with the new African Union. We're reaching out to black people in the diaspora. We need to make international ties. And we need to not only disseminate information to the outside world as opposed to media dissemination, we need to receive information from the outside world. So to motivate our people, we have to give them a new vision of possibility. And they have to think beyond America's borders. And they have to understand the possibility of their role. If there are 110 million people who didn't vote in the year 2000, the NAACP, Tom Joyner, all registered about 2 million. We need to register people to vote. We need to explain to them that this is not an immediate fix, because we are suffering from a problem that began in 19. It began with Gold War, but it consolidated itself with Reagan and Bush. The problem is we have a generation of folk. What we have is those of us who are over 50, some of us over 55. We can remember the world when it was different. We can remember our grandparents talking about the Depression and World War II, and we can remember the movement when we almost changed this country. Lerone has a piece that he mentioned once at IBW, talked about the revolution that almost came. But this generation has grown up under an atmosphere and a culture where right-wing vision of the world has become conventional wisdom. And that's what they have been the last 20, 25 years. The stuff that passes as conventional wisdom is simply right-wing bromides. So we have to try and re-educate people to the point that this is a stage in history. We came up during the age of revolution. We came up when revolution was de rigueur in China, in Africa, in Cuba, everywhere. Some that failed in Brazil and elsewhere. Some that failed is in the Philippines. But it was the age of revolution. This is now the age of the counter-revolution, but it is an age. What is different about it is that it is in the hands of such people who may destroy the world. The polar ice cap is melting. Species are dying. I fly in here and you have wildfires and there are droughts and thousands of people died in France. Aznar lied in Spain and said only 58 people died, but I was there when the cows and the pigs were dying. If they do not do something about global warming, we may all perish. So I don't think we should alarm people about that, but people need to understand that this is a different kind of danger and requires a different kind of politics that we need to begin, as John Kennedy said, the step to take. We're not going to overturn these turkeys overnight, but we must begin the journey to overturn them. And we must re-educate folks to do so. So I said we must reach out, form international ties. We must talk about structural change like banning the Electoral College. We must register people to vote. And we must get corporations out of the media business. Corporations must be taken out of. That's what Gingrich did. Gingrich gave away the public airwaves to Murdoch. Murdoch gave him a $4.5 million book deal. There was a little outcry about ooh, so he then only got $2.5 million off the top, we think. But he's given away the air. Because there was an outcry, Powell Jr. Was going to give them even more power. But the FCC had to back down to him. But they have the same goals in mind vis-a-vis today's New York Times, more tax cuts for corporations. And they don't understand that they are destructive even of their own interests. If the planet dies, the dummies die too. They die too. It's not like the old days when slavery, you can say slave master, he exploits the labor or the kings exploit the serfs. They have let loose forces they cannot control. Cancer. They want to bioengineer the food. They want to clone beef. They've already started cloning. It's a new thing. So they want to clone milk, clone the beef, clone the food. You're putting that stuff in your system. They don't know what it's going to do to you. You might, what's that flick alien when the dude jumps out of the tum-tum? You'll be there, in an intimate moment, something jump out of your tum-tum. No, I mean, these people are out to lunch. But people don't want to deal with how out to lunch they are and the consequences of out to lunchness. Paul? Yes, one of my friends, the famous playwright Paul Carter Harris.
Listen, Phil, aside from vote registration, can you rely on the old structures to carry your message? The old structures that are like NAACP, et cetera, and further, or I should ask, are there any vanguard movements that can carry your particular message? At this moment, since it's so critical, 2004.
Now you're right, I mean, we don't have a movement. There is a country, I mean, NAA has some possibilities. People recognize the name, which may or may not. You've got Julian versus Infume. Julian Infume gave an NAACP award to Condoleezza Rice. Mm-hmm. Right. So Julian, in response, gave an award to Aaron Magruder, who's the cartoonist for Boondocks. It will be a struggle. It may not. We may not be able to use old institutions. Therefore, we may have to create some new ones, which is why we need. Which is why this particular intellectual and political vacuum is really a challenge for new theory and new movement. We know that the old kind of civil rights strategies are no longer sufficient. That's why we need our best brains to think about how to overcome. And one of the reasons the Vietnamese were so successful, they had three simple rules. Understand the enemy, understand yourself, and build a plan based on reality. We have to deal with our own internal contradictions. The drug question when the Boggs years ago talked about was you couldn't go and organize people the way you did in the old days because with the gangbangers, people were afraid to come out of their houses at night. So we have tremendous problems internally as well as the madness externally that I've tried to enumerate on today. So yeah, we need to, all doors should be open. All things should be tried. But first we must get people to understand that the effort must be made. You cannot give up and think it doesn't make a difference because in many instances we are the balance. We have something most of white America does not, at least we used to. There's this true story of Reconstruction about a slave, ex-slave, Freedman, whose name I don't know, we'll call him Sam. And during Reconstruction policies, he ran into his master, his former master, and they were still, in conversation with one another. And the master said to him, he said, Sam, tell me something. He said, you don't read, and you
don't write, but you always know whom to vote for. How do you do that? And Sam said, well, Master, I just listen to what you white folks say, and then I does the opposite. We used to know in the old days that if A was true, B must follow. But we don't know that anymore. That instinctive dialectical response has been lost. We need folk to understand if Cracker A is doing this, we must do something else. We cannot, there's a movie, a 1965 movie called The Bedford Incident with Sidney Poitier and Richard Widmark, where Sidney kind of plays the Gordon Parks character and Widmark is the kind of Cold War commander of the destroyer. And he's out in the North Sea messing around with a special submarine, and finally they go through incident. And finally they get upright, and they nuke it. And while they're sitting around congratulating one another, the radar operator says, oh, there are beeps on the radar. So before the Russian sub had sank, they had launched two. And so you see at the end of the flick, you see Sidney sits standing on the deck waiting for the nuke hit, which is a fundamental lesson. We are all on this ship called America, or on Du Bois's train, and we could be traveling in steerage, or first class, or second class, or even be a Judas like Roy Connolly. If the ship goes down, we go down too. And folk need to know that our fate is inextricably tied to the fate of this nation. You may run around and do drugs, or do alcohol, or do womanizing, or do manizing, or do dope, or whatever. I'm going to have to get colloquial. We better get our shit together. We better get it together. Because if we don't do it, what we have is that we used to have that old Sam wisdom. We have a critique. This is why 90% of us, you know, vote Democratic as opposed to. We have a critique of America, the Jimmy Baldwin, because we know the other side of their face. That's from Marlon Brando, One-Eyed Jack. Anybody ever seen One-Eyed Jack? He says, you may be a One-Eyed Jack around here, Dad, but I've seen the other side of your face. We've seen the other side of America's face. And while there are folk who are in denial, as I said, don't want to believe in American evil, we do have a capacity to try and educate, as Jesse did to us. We tripled our white vote in 88, to speak to our fellow citizens and try and explain to them just how ridiculous this cowboyism is. They may want to be John Wayne, but John Wayne can lead them to the eternal burial.
No, I wanted to ask a question. It seems as though blacks are accused of committing two crimes. One is not voting, and the other one is voting for the Democratic Party. And in your presentation, I was struck by the fact that you, at no point, even in the question and answer session, talked about the Green Party, because certainly 10, 20 years ago, there was talk about this third force, and you're from Amherst, and John Anderson, when he ran, was a bit of a hero up there. And it seems as though this third party, this third force, and in California, I guess the Green Party were considering themselves that third force, was speaking more directly to the issues that you're talking about, namely the policies, economic policies that are redistributing wealth, for example. And Peter Conejo was stressing that point, to the point that when on the election night, when he was giving his concession speech and was trying to stress that point again, the networks cut him off. What is your take on the Green Party, and is that part of the new politics that you see Black America and others turning to?
Okay, this goes to a shortcoming of Jesse's campaign. Jesse is a wonderful political developer, and he will political gorilla. So he will be in, you know, he was in Harvard putting the work, because he was out here with Green Davis. But he failed to do real organization. Push Rainbow is nice, but it ain't a real political organization that can contest for power. So that in Massachusetts, Mel King, who ran for mayor of Boston in 1980, we tried to build something to maintain something. And in fact, we've now arranged, I mentioned it via West Central College, there's now a
alliance between the Rainbow Party and the Green Party in Massachusetts, and we're on the ballot. So that we, to the extent that the Green Party here, like sometimes the Green, the Grüne in Germany, have a different perspective, a helpful perspective, that's cool. Except the problem is, we need to get to the masses. And what history has shown, they kept NATO out of the debates. They kept Ross Perot with all of his billions out of the debates. So that we needed to have at least a dual strategy. If there's some possibility of Green to independent politics being relevant, that's cool. But we have to get access, as Jesse did, to the media. And the only way we can get them in the debate is by being in the Democratic Party. So even though I supported the Green-Rainbow Alliance for this election, as I said, my strategy is we must push the Democratic Party to relevance. That's why, as I said, it's not relevant who the candidate is. If we can create in this country a critique of what is wrong, and force it on the Democratic Party to represent that critique and get that critique out into the public arena, that is will have more of an effect of re-educating people than having the right word, having the correct line, and being shut out of the debate. We can have the correct line. It's like the vanity of writing. You have the right stuff, you have the vanity, which is wonderful. But if nobody reads it, then what? It's like the tree falling in the forest. Yeah, nobody reads your stuff. The message must be gotten. It's like we have to be both idealistic and pragmatic. World War I is World War I, and Lenin, and the Germans send Lenin to the Finland station because they know if he gets into Russia, he will pull Russia out of the war. And when he gets there, what does he find? He finds that Stalin and Sverdlov are running Pravda and supporting Kerensky. He says, are you crazy? So that whatever will get us to get the word out must be considered, despite whether or not the correct line may exist in some other venue. If we can't get the correct line to the masses, then it's useless. So we must think objectively.
On that score, what is your evaluation of Governor Keene?
Dean,
is that his name?
Yeah. Same thing, I don't concern myself with. I mean, the guy who has the correct line of all the candidates is Kucinich. Kucinich has the correct line, I mean, from my point of view. In the debates, which you never see, Sharpton kills the people. Sharpton ain't serious. Sharpton will raise stuff, but he ain't serious. It's unfortunate, because in the rhetorical thing, he's wonderful. But just taking them as they are, somebody who is critiquing things and getting people to understand the fallacies of existing positions, Sharpton is very, very good. Except he's not concerned about real. He doesn't have any kind of strategy for real. It's self-promotion as opposed to social change. So, as I say, if we can move Dean, it's our responsibility to build a kind of mass movement that can make these mouthpiece for us and the people, as opposed to just individual opportunism. I mean, I support the devil thing, but it doesn't say it right. You're on the right path. This is another Malcolm story. Malcolm was debating Mark Duell Powell at Hoffman Harvard many years ago. And Mark Duell says, look, Mr. X, I've seen this, how intelligent you are. And it's certainly a man of your intelligence came in. White people, the devil. Malcolm says, well, if you're not the devil, prove it. And that's my line on the bush. If you ain't the devil, prove it. Sir, you had your hand up.
Yes. My question is to you, is the Democratic Party relevant? Because when you look at the election in Florida, the Republicans and the Democrats pursued a similar policy of recounting selective counties versus insisting upon shutting everything down in a total recount. So why, in your opinion, why did the Democrats not pursue a realistic recount versus Gore picked a couple of counties and Bush picked a couple of counties and that solved their problem?
No, the problem's not solved. Jesus Christ could have come down. They were going to steal the election. The as part of the misdirection of blame the voting and the machines and Gore's strategy. If the court had ruled, if the counts had, if they had kept counting and Gore had won, the state legislature of Florida, Republican, were prepared to declare that null and void and choose electors for Bush. If you read Jake Tapper's book called Dirty, I think it's called Dirty Tricks about the Florida election, which is one of the reasons, in my judgment, the court stepped in, because they were really about to expose who the Republicans were and how corrupt the system is. The Republicans were prepared to do anything so that the voting thing was, as far as they were concerned, if X didn't happen, they were prepared to do Y. And if Y didn't happen, they were prepared to do Z. And that would have exposed the bankruptcy of this democracy like nothing else. So the Supreme Court stepped in. The same people who say, you know, they're for states' rights, they stepped in just like Ashcroft is for states' rights, except in Oregon with his assisted suicide, he steps in. And now he's going around intervening in state prosecutions where there are defendants who have, that he wants to execute. So he was going to do it in New York with some, I'm trying to find out whether these guys were black. Their name is Cadillac Impact. But they came into Massachusetts. We had this case of this black and white pedophile who kidnapped this little white boy and raped him and killed him. They both got life. So Ashcroft is trying to do Willie Horton. He wants to come into Massachusetts and retry the black guy to use the little racist ploy. Here's this black pedophile murderer, and give him the death penalty. At the moment, the Attorney General and the legislature are resisting it. But these people will do anything, say anything. If states' rights will aid their cause, then they'll say. If it's federal intervention, then they'll do that. They are unprincipled. All they do is give rationalizations which the white country accepts. Especially since they don't think it's them. Who are the people being held in detention? Who are the Americans whom they have labeled enemy combatants, whom they will not allow to have lawyers? They're not white. And one of the funny things, I have relatives living in Michigan, and these same Arabs used to call themselves the Michigan Chaldeans, and they used to exploit the black community. They're now called sand niggers. They round up 5,000 of them. And the people who they're being deported without knowledge and information as part of the whole secrecy. So folk who came to America and thought that they could get over, which is another reason we need to speak up, this whole thing is racist. They won't tell you how many Iraqis they killed. The Pentagon says that's not relevant. So how many did they kill in this so-called war? Iraqi casualties don't count. In 1991, Mr. Cheney presided over the American troops buried Iraqi soldiers alive. Check. Buried them alive. No publicity. 6 weeks ago, you had an ABC reporter who talked about the unhappiness of South American troops, and they attacked him. They said, oh, he's gay and he's anti-Bush. And then they attack Joe Wilson's wife. So there's no dissent. You get Bush goes around on these speaking engagements, or Cheney goes to the Heritage Foundation last week, a selected right-wing audience, speaks for 25 minutes and does not permit questions, even from his own people. Bush goes around, this is a tremendous case in so-called Democratic America. Bush goes last year to South Carolina to raise money. The police move the protesters away, so you never see them on TV. This one dude is there with a sign that says, "No blood for oil." He is a